All right, guys, here we are to talk about Season 5, Episode 31 of The Twilight Zone.
What'd you think?
Well, I liked at least 5 seconds of this episode a lot.
Which 5 seconds?
At the end when he's like, Banzai!
Oh, I hated those 5 seconds.
Because it's so, there's no, like, a lot of this episode, well, A, there's like no moral, really, because it affects two people in a different way for, like, completely different reasons.
He says guilt or something, right?
One is guilt, like, oh no, my father did something wrong, and one is, oh no, I'm a dirty murderer, and we should both suffer the same fate.
I don't know why that guy, him yelling banzai and jumping out, you know, out the window was like, I threw up my hands like, what is this
crap? It reminded me of when that bus driver jumped out of the window.
Like, yeah, but this is not supposed to be funny. This is supposed to be like a thing. And even if you go like, oh, it's a cursed samurai sword or something like that, it still doesn't make it. That's
so the episode is a man, it is down in his luck, he's cleaning out his attic. Along comes a man who's seemingly has a scheduled appointment to be like, hey, I'm here to give you the quote for mowing your lawn.
Yeah, it was a different time. He just went door to door. Hey, I see you got a thing. Can I do something for you?
So he comes up. He's like, yeah, sure. I agree to your terms. Come up here and have a beer with me. Maybe help me clean out this attic.
And the beer is in like the old cans, like a soup can. I was like, all right.
So you're like, all right, what's going to happen here? Like, you saw him like playing with a sword for a second and throw it away. And the guy comes up there and he starts being really racist and weird. He fought in the war, so he has some, viewpoints Japanese Americans.
So yeah, there's like moments where it's like yikes, right? Yeah. Those things, right? But I love I thought it was very funny how they chose an actor for like the shape of that dude's face. Mm-hmm. Neville Brand, the like racist vet guy, looked like, you know, like a monkey. He had a weird like
he reminded
face
me of Fred Flintstone.
Yes, he looked like a Neanderthal. And said, "We thought your people were apes," and I'm like, "What? If anyone's an ape here, it's you."
He speaks to what, the science officer? What was George Takei in Star Trek?
I don't know.
He speaks to a man of the future.
Yeah, and that's who I was like, oh, that's the most Japanese dude ever. And then it's like, he looks very familiar, actually. Wait a minute. This is young George Takei. What the hell's going on here? Amazing.
And that was fine. They played back and forth a little bit here and there, but it seemed to drop me a couple of times.
I want to defend the old, I don't know what to call it, I forget his name, but like the older dudes, his like story.
Racist McGee?
Yeah, like how it unravels his character. I like love that stuff.
Like how he lies.
Yes.
Doesn't even, like, he didn't even just get, like, he didn't get tripped up. He just goes like, that didn't happen. He's like, you're right, it didn't.
Like, no, like I love that when there's like a few characters and he goes like, after 50 years, they dropped me from the company. What? Because of one lousy, what? A man can't appreciate a woman, say she looks nice, change with the times. And then slowly you find out, oh my God, this guy's a horrible creep. He starts the whole thing. Now she's buried under the stairs. Who's laughing
but
now?
But he kind of did the heel turn like real early. He immediately was like, oh, he's a scumbag. And then it's like, he was drinking on the job. Oh, look, he's drinking now. What a surprise.
I love the like development of that, because
where
it starts
it twisted
out like
on
yo
me
and it
is
happens.
When he's like, have a look at this sword, and he starts like wielding it, and then like as if like they into like a like altercation where he has like a trench knife and he has the sword, and then like as he's gonna kill him he goes, ah, I'm kidding or some shit, and it just stops.
The worst part is when George Takei goes crazy and is screaming and ranting and raving and running around. That was like supposed to be whatever that was supposed to be, but I thought it was like way over the top and campy and weird and bad, and I was like, I hate this, all about this, whatever.
How about when he's alone and he's just like, I'm gonna kill him. I'm going
That's
to
fine.
Kill him.
Yeah. Like, because then it's like a cursed sword or whatever. Yeah, and I was getting behind all that or whatever. So like, I just thought it was way too weird. And then like the bonsai thing at the end, I was like, this is so weird. This doesn't make sense anymore. All things done or whatever.
He was committing suicide.
Right. Well, yeah, I understand what happened on the screen, but why does that happen? That's dumb.
I don't know why it happens. Yeah. I will say it is certainly dumb.
If, like,
and that's why I like, because I really wasn't, I was like, there were some decent like monologues in this episode.
Yeah.
But overall, I hate the thing where it's like, so what am I to take away from this? It's like, don't let your parents have a horrible secret that'll make you ultimately try to kill somebody and throw yourself out of a window.
Like, if it was clear that it was a like possessed sword or something like that, or we had a thing with a thing or something, or if he had given away more reasons why he wants to kill himself or something like that, then that would have, but that whole outside of it like makes no sense.
Like,
but
you could have made this into a good. My tweak to make this into a better episode would have been like, upon him showing him the sword, he goes, "Can you translate that?" He reads it, and then all of a sudden,
and that's
he
a spell.
Becomes that guy that he killed in the field, and like, so like, you see like his look change for slightly, and then the guy's saying like, "I took this off of blah blah blah, I snuck around him. It's better to be dumb and lucky than smart and good, whatever the fuck he says." And then at that point, he goes, "No, you didn't.
Right?
You killed a man kneeling before you to give you this sword to surrender," and like. He is that guy.
Right.
And that's what you should have done.
And I don't know if they were going for that and didn't make it clear enough, because he does seem to know things he shouldn't be able to know, right? So what's going on there? Yeah. So I don't know what the deal is with that. But I liked both performances otherwise. I like the ending with like the door creaking open and all that stuff.
Yeah. We're not meant to leave.
Yeah. Well, and it's weird for him to call that out.
That's
but that's
issue.
Like that's like the time period or whatever.
But yeah, you're thinking your audience is too dumb to realize like this isn't coincidence, people.
Sure, sure.
He grabs the camera. Listen.
Yeah, listen. No, like compared to an episode like having two people stuck in a thing, getting progressively more like you know like unhinged and the performances and stuff. I did not hate this episode. I thought it was better than a lot of the other ones that are just not even a Twilight Zone episode at all, right?
Yeah.
This whole thing of like finding a sword and two people in these weird with all this baggage and then you know doing this inexplicable thing, something you'd hear about and be like, what the hell happened at Johnson's house? And it's like. There's no explanation for this crazy thing that happened.
The problem with it for me is just that they are in the middle of suburbia at the time.
Yeah.
Like, he even mentions all the things we could do if we had to get out of here. Like, oh,
yeah.
Like they could break the door. They just choose not to because, like, you know, oh, we'll pop the hinges because we don't want to, this is my house, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
Yeah, we could break the window and scream for help.
Right.
You could probably even lower yourself down, like, even if you're floors up.
They start fighting to, like, stop doing that.
Well, I know, but it seemed like everything escalated like that. The way that stuff happened to me would have been they should have played up how swelteringly hot the attic is, and there are no other ways out. Like, there's no window. We tried to break the door, we couldn't get out, and it's increasing the tension and stuff. And I know it's only 22 minutes,
sure.
You don't have the ability to do that, but it. And they're forcing a narrative of like they're both, you know, the guilty idiots with blah blah blah. I just think you could have done a little more.
Yeah, I didn't. I didn't like George. You know, Arthur's backstory or whatever. I didn't like
Taro,
that whole.
Taro.
Yeah, but using the dialogue really carries this for me, and I like. There are some shots of like sweaty faces and people.
Yeah,
getting weird
and that's
whatever.
Why I was like, oh, play that up more.
We don't have enough time or whatever to like.
Because he says at one point, like, drink the beer. You need it. He's like.
Yeah. You need one of those, because he's all, like upset or whatever. But, like, the way that it turns, too, I really like how he's like, oh, come on now, there's traitors on both sides. Sit down, Taro. Arthur. And starts, like, correcting it the other way, and I'm like, oh, this is a cool, like, thing or whatever.
Yeah.
But the bonsai and the moral aspect and, like, the structure.
Even how
like,
it ultimately fell, because, like, they can't show blood and this and that. Like,
right.
Because it's
confused.
Like, it's okay, what did he get skewered in the heart? And then, like, it shows him from, like, here up, and you're like, there's no mark.
The angle of the sword and, like, how the shots are put together, I was, like, super confused.
Like, it should have fallen onto like his neck or his chest or something, but it seemingly got him in the stomach.
The way the shots worked, I thought it was like laying on the table and like his neck hits the table. It's Million Dollar Baby, but it cuts it or something. But we are to believe that it like kicked up and stabbed him or whatever.
Yeah, because it was aiming. It was up at an angle and he fell on it.
Right.
And then I'm like, oh, okay. Arthur's gonna like leave. It'll look because like it was embedded. He had to like yank it out.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, it'll look like he fell. It was a cluttered thing. And that okay, or you got your revenge, whatever.
Or he'll like freak out. You'll have a thing with cops, and he's like, "I have no memory of anything that happened today." And the whole audience will be like, "He was possessed by a samurai." Like it'll be right. You'll do something.
But
like
then
that.
He like you know muscles the sword out of there and then jumps out the window. It's done.
It's a very weird bad ending of this.
What did Rod say at the end? What was his ending like?
I don't
know. Twilight Zone. Don't be possessed. Like.
No, I mean, like, this is often my complaint about Twilight Zone things, where Rod's, I think last time I was like, and he has the audacity to come in and be like, don't drink and drive or something like that. I forget what he said here. I just remember, like, him mentioning, like, the guilt of the people or something like that. So I like this because, to, like, the police that will show up, no one's going to be like, it's one of those possessed swords. Like, it's a weird thing happening that causes, like...
If it would have been a different case that Arthur was under, I think it would have been better for him.
I don't know if we needed his backstory. Or any of this crazy stuff with his father or any of this stuff or his overacting
the
of like,
breaking
ah!
down and the lying
things.
And the immediately turning like and to tell the truth about how your dad was a spy at Pearl Harbor.
That.
I'm like,
it's like delivered.
Why is that your cross to bear?
Because I thought otherwise his performance was like good, but that one like section was so clunky and weird. Like,
yeah.
Whatever. But
was not one of my favorite episodes.
I'm more positive on it than you, but yeah, it's not in my top 10, certainly, or whatever.
Especially
right?
To waste a recognizable person for me. And I know, going into it, they didn't know it was
only that had a time machine. Yeah.
But it would be like if you had one with...
William Shatner!
Well, with Shatner, it was bad. It would be the like, oh, cast. Man, what are you doing with Shatner? Why? Because the two that he's in, I'm like, those are pretty good.
Those are pretty good.
Yeah. So come on.
I didn't even know George Takei was in the Twilight Zone.
No, yeah, he took me as a nice little surprise. I didn't remember this episode at all.
And I thought the other guy reminded me of the dude in the episode where everyone has like pig faces and they're trying to make the like
was
woman.
It him?
It's not him. Mm. And his name's Neville Brand, which sounds familiar, and he has like 150.
Reminds you of Neville Sinclair.
There were some Nevilles back then. That was like a more common thing. He has 150 acting credits or something. I'm sure I've seen him around or something, but I was looking at his face.
He's in every episode of Twilight Zone except for the one you watched.
Except that one. No, he's been in no other episodes of The Twilight Zone, so it's like a huge letdown.
Such a good actor, he has different names.
No, I liked him a lot. I thought they picked a good, like you said, Fred Flintstone guy of the time to deliver all that whole
thing. Yeah, they could have put him in The Honeymooners.
And I liked the like weaving of the story and the peeling back of the layers of his stupid like thing.
I just thought the peel revealed dumb things.
Yeah.
You could have taken those same premise and twist and mostly just on George's angle.
No, that's the that's where falls there or whatever, right? Yeah.
Because having them be like, oh, they're parallels. Look, see, they both have dirty secrets, and they're both this and that. And, oh, the white man, and the Asian man.
Because that's what you were waiting for, was like an unusually woke turn where like, oh, they both got their things. And then Rod's bookends kind of hint at like they both have their things. But George's thing is not like the same thing at all.
Yeah, maybe if you're going to be a little bit more like deep cutty on this, maybe the guy he killed was his father.
Yeah.
And he raped his mother, and he's now here in America to get revenge.
So he's his son in this example? His long-lost son?
Yes.
Oh, I know all about you. Yeah. Oh, I can translate it.
Well, like it's like that was my father's sword. Mm.
Exactly.
That's much better. Do that.
Okay.
Mm. All right, guys. That's this episode of Twilight Zone. Let us know in the comments what you thought about it. Don't die in a fire, and we'll see you next time.
Hello, internets. I just love watching Just Daggers. If you've enjoyed this video as much as I have, click that subscribe button. Peace out, homies.